morning. Please sit down. Mr. Grewal,
yes, sir.
Your first preference is the foreign service?
Yes, sir.
Why is that?
Sir, although I have been inclined towards civil services since childhood, my interest in foreign service began when my father spent his 2 tenures in the UN peacekeeping force. And in college also, I had a Japanese roommate and an Australian warden. Plus, a lot of distinguished alumni from college came to give lectures on the foreign service, so that inspired me to. Also, sir, I'm a huge fan of Adventures of Tintin, so he was the first inspiration.
Where was your father posted in the peacekeeping force?
So he did a tenure in Ethiopia and another one in South Sudan.
Okay. Did you visit those places?
No, sir.
You could. Were families allowed there or not?
No, sir. Okay. So there's a station in Djibouti for families, but you can't go further.
Okay. Right. So foreign service is your first preference. So please explain to me, what is this issue over the Brexit? They are talking of a backstop clause.
Yes,
and what exactly is it?
So backstop clause is regarding the agreement of the Britain with Ireland. So their territory in Northern Ireland should have, they're trying to avoid a hard border with Ireland, because Ireland wants to is a part of the European Union, but according to the Brexit referendum, Northern Ireland territory actually voted to remain in the EU, which was different from the popular opinion of the British people. That's why, so a backstop agreement allows them to trade freely and move across the border, which
will remain a part of the customs union.
Yes, yes.
In the US,
yes, sir.
Now, what is this, they had something called a federal shutdown. How did that result in, what was the situation, the circumstances which led to that?
So, the United States, in the United States you have a separation of powers model. So, legislature is different from, like, it has separate powers from the executive. So.
Mm-hmm.
Presently in legislature, the weight of the Democrats is more than the Republicans, and though they still have the Senate, but because according to the president who wanted he wanted to build a wall and wanted a budget for $5.7 billion, and the legislature didn't agree to do it. So it was his prerogative to hold a shutdown through the executive, because the president is the head of the executive.
Basically, going about it in a round and round way, basically the finance bill, as
yes,
it's called in India,
yes,
that has to be
it's
proposed by the House of Representatives.
Yes,
it has to have the signature of the US president.
Yes,
the president was saying that if you do not give me this money, I will not pass the budget, and hence the resolution comes. Now, they are also having this problem of, a special counsel has been appointed there. Are you aware of that special counsel, Robert Mueller, who is looking into
the collusion case?
Yeah, what is that case all about?
So it's regarding the 2016 elections, presidential elections. Their Mueller probe is about the collusion between Russian authorities and the campaign for President
Donald Trump. Yes. Right. Okay. Okay. Now let's come to India.
Yes.
We keep on hearing this theory of string of pearls.
Yes.
What is the string of pearls?
So string of pearls is a strategy of China, supposed strategy of China to counter India's influence in the Indian through a network of ports. For example, China's string of pearls, I would say, extends from, they have a military base in Djibouti, to their influence in Maldives, to the Hambantota port in Sri Lanka. Then we have the Chittagong port in Bangladesh, which and they are also discussing a Kyokpyu port in Myanmar. I'm not sure if that's the correct pronunciation.
Yeah, but Maldives, they don't have a port. They have a Hambantota,
yes,
you're right.
Yes,
you have forgotten, you have not completed the stay here. After Djibouti, if you move further north, what
is Gwadar?
Yes. Gwadar is the thing. Now, Gwadar is a part of what?
So, CPEC.
CPEC. Where does it start?
So, it starts from Kashgar and extends to the port of Gwadar.
Now, the Chinese are spending about $55-60 billion on this CPEC.
Yes, sir.
Why are they spending so much money? What is the strategic significance of CPEC for China?
So it directly connects the territory. It counters India's influence through the Gilgit-Baltistan route, also from Kashmir.
That is a cause of concern for us.
Yes, sir.
But what is the strategic significance of this?
So CPEC also cuts off India's alleged influence through the Chabahar port.
We don't have a naval base there, we just primarily for oil and all. Think about it, what is the distance? How do Chinese carry their goods, their crude oil now? How do they carry it to China? What is the route which they take?
Through the Gulf, through Gwadar, yes.
Not now. Before Gwadar comes out,
yes, sir.
How was China acquiring their resources from the rest of the world? The sea route.
Yes, sir.
The sea route through where?
Indian Ocean, right from Malacca Strait.
Malacca Straits, the South China Seas, and then to their eastern port.
Yes, sir.
That's about 12,000 kilometers.
Yes, yes, sir.
And the distance between Gwadar and Lingjiang, yes, is about 3,000 kilometers.
Yes,
that is the basic thing.
Yes, sir.
And the choke point which was there, that of course, that problem is no longer. That will be cut through the issue.
Yes, sir.
Why they have been living wanting this. Now, papers have been reporting today,
yes,
that the Chinese have said that they will again withhold their support to India's case for NSG.
Yes,
why is that?
So, NSG is a consensus-based organization. So, even if one member blocks it, then the entry to a new member is blocked, and India is opposed to the primarily the project of
ODO. What is the Chinese stand? I mean, what is the supposed stand in denying this to us?
So they say that India has not signed the NPT. Yeah,
that's,
yes,
they have not signed the NPT.
Yes,
thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Vikram.
Yes, sir.
History is your option.
Yes, sir.
Tell me the social reforms,
yes,
which took place in India,
yes,
in the 19th century.
Yes, sir. The 19th century is considered to be the age of Renaissance for India when it comes to social reforms. It started with Raja Ram Mohan Roy. And
What happened?
He basically tried to reinterpret sort of come with a synthesis of Western and Eastern elements together to basically conciliate colonial ideas as well as India's own original ideas from the Upanishads and the Vedanta philosophy. And it also led to two basic strands of Reformation and Revivalism.
What are the reforms?
So reforms started with the abolition of sati, and there was the Thuggee Act brought in by Lord William Bentinck. It went on to the abolition of child marriage in 1846, if I'm not wrong. Then it also led to establishment of various social reform institutions and sabhas.
Then go on.
Yes, sir.
Raja Ram Mohan Roy, and then.
There was a change in attitudes regarding widow remarriage brought out by Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar ji. There was a sort of renaissance in the western coast as well, under Deccan Sabha and a lot of other organizations working also under. Yes, sir.
There were a number of reform movements.
Yes, sir.
So you are not able to recollect.
Yes, sir.
Dayanand Saraswati.
Yes,
sir. Arya Samaj. Brahmo Samaj.
Yes, sir.
Neo Brahmo Samaj. Keshav Chandra Sen.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Then of course Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar,
yes,
then Swami Vivekananda,
yes,
then Parthana Samaj,
yes, Prada
Samaj.
Yeah. Yes,
so all these you have to, you know, history, you know. Otherwise also for GS you should be knowing.
Yes, sir,
you have read all this,
yes,
isn't it?
I was unable to arrange it.
Okay, tell me, you know, though Britishers had left us,
yes,
but there are some British legacy,
yes,
which we are still enjoying, you know, the fruits of those legacy.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Just name one or two, you know, what are those legacy which, you know, we Indians after independence, those British legacy, you know, it has helped us in growing as a nation, in furthering our character.
Yes, sir. So, among the most important legacies would be the development of civil services, the armed forces, which carry a colonial legacy, and their present structure is also very similar to what began during the
war. Of course, one, you said that the civil service, but civil service is, but you know, the main important ones you just said.
So, the constitution is the biggest,
yes,
colonial legacy.
Because this 1935 was what?
Government of India.
Government of India.
Yes, sir.
So, our constitution was drafted on those lines.
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
So, that is one.
Yes, sir.
Then?
Then I would say, sir,
even a history student,
yes,
you should be able to say.
Sir, regarding the socio-cultural aspect, even the monuments which were built are...
Monuments, no. Mughal monuments were also great.
No,
yes,
but
the education, this Western education,
yes,
not, you know, this education,
yes,
so very secular education.
Yes, sir.
Constitution is one,
yes, sir,
which is this thing. Then this education, the railway system.
Yes,
do you know after independence how much broad gauge we have added?
No, sir.
Should read all this.
Yes, sir.
Only less than 10%. What there? When was in railway introduced in India?
So 1850 to
1853.
Yes, 1853.
So during their time, whatever railways, they had commercial interest, but it is a great benefit to us.
Yes, sir.
Okay, tell me something about Udan.
So the regional
connectivity. Udan, regional connectivity.
Yes, sir. Sir, Udan is the regional connectivity scheme. Of Ministry of Civil Aviation, and it basically enables low cost travel, air travel to especially the middle class of Indians who are increasing in the percentage, and plus the infrastructure development of tier 2, tier 3 cities is also happening, and a lot of airports are being developed, and it is a phase wise scheme. So recently, Udan 2.0 and 3.0 is also.
You mentioned.
Yes, sir.
You see, it is like a regional connectivity scheme where unserved and underserved.
Yes,
you should say
unserved
that.
And
underserved
airports
are connected,
yes,
and then there is a subsidy component.
Yes, sir.
That up to 1 hour.
Yes, sir.
2500. How could they do this? Matlab, you know, because it requires some subsidy component.
Yes, yes.
Where from that fund comes?
Sir, I'm not aware, sir.
Viability gap funding. You read about.
Oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Viability gap. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I have read about.
So, those airlines which will go for this Udan,
yes,
scheme,
sir,
and for this amount, they will be given from this viability gap,
yes,
funding.
Sir.
And in budget, there is some amount kept for this.
Yes,
okay.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. There is another Udan scheme. You have any idea?
Sir, it's regarding Kashmir, sir.
Yes, Jammu and Kashmir.
Education of girl children. Sir.
No, not that.
For IIT.
Those who are technical, for giving them skills,
yes,
after,
sir,
plus two,
yes, sir,
making them more employable.
Yes,
okay.
Yes, sir.
So this is a scheme by Ministry of Commerce.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
You're from Stephens.
Yes, ma'am.
Stephens was accredited recently.
Yes, ma'am.
So they got a rating of A++. And on the basis of that, it was said that all colleges which got this rating could go for autonomy.
Yes,
so has Stevens opted for autonomy?
Yes, ma'am. They unilaterally proposed to go for autonomy.
So they also now talk of contract teachers.
Yes,
not regular teachers, but taking teachers on contract. What are your views on this?
Ma'am, I personally have not formed an opinion on this. But regarding autonomy, I think the DU Act mentions that, DU Act 1922 mentions that only engineering, medical, and music and arts, performing arts colleges can be given autonomy. Otherwise, these colleges.
But now UGC has said that these colleges can opt for autonomy, and Stevens has opted for autonomy.
Yes, ma'am.
Though there's a lot of protest
yes,
amongst the
yes,
faculty, but they have gone ahead. All right, now you've also directed documentaries and short films.
Yes, ma'am.
So, what is the difference between a documentary and a short film?
Ma'am, a short film, according to Indian standard, is one which is less than 72 minutes, or if we talk about film, it's less than 2000 meter of film. A documentary is a film which can be a short film and can be a feature length film also, but on it's a film on actual, it's like a non-fiction film.
A documentary, but even a short film can be a non-fiction.
Yes, ma'am.
Then what's the difference?
It will be a docu short film only.
All right. So, what were the documentary issues that you took up in your film?
Yes,
in the documentary.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, the first film which I made was Kashmir, the Fenced Paradise. It was a travelogue on Kashmir Valley. And the second one was History of the Horse, which was a college project on horse castle history.
All right. Now, you've also written that you published three books.
Yes, ma'am.
What were these books on? What were the issues?
Yes, ma'am. First was a novel, which was based on, it was a superhero fiction. So it
okay,
was
so you wrote a novel, all
yes,
right?
It
and
was
you published
yes, ma'am. It was published by Diamond Pocket Books.
Okay.
I originally wanted to be a comic, but I realized they also publish scripts now.
Okay.
Earlier, they used to publish comics only, charges all the year.
So is it an illustrated novel? So the second one?
The other two are self-published poetry collections.
Poetry?
Yes, ma'am.
If I asked you to recite a poem from your collection, one stanza, would you be able to recite?
Yes, ma'am.
Let's hear.
One of the collection is called Ink and Solitude.
Hmm.
So it's regarding the two basic things a writer needs to develop something.
Okay.
So it's ink I need to realize on paper, the thoughts before wandering free, and solitude around I covet to find the verse hidden in me.
Good. Now I come to something more concrete.
Yes, ma'am.
There's an attempt to rewrite history
yes, ma'am.
In our country.
Yes, ma'am.
So what are your views?
Ma'am, I think history rewriting would be good if it's based on historical evidence and facts, and if it provides a good perspective based on historical evidence. Otherwise, if it is communally motivated or it's a non-academic practice, then it will be a disservice to the subject.
Okay. You've heard of the Niti Aayog?
Yes, ma'am.
Tell me something about the Niti Aayog.
Ma'am, Niti Aayog replaced the Planning Commission after the new regime came into power.
What is its role?
It's a think tank, ma'am. Other than just planning and documenting schemes and indexes regarding different aspects, it also undertakes projects like utter tinkering labs or small incubation centers.
So we also have a term known as cooperative federalism, especially associated with the IOB. Why is that so?
And because it has a balance of ex officio and governing members from different states. All CMs are also part of the governing council. So they together can brainstorm, which would lead to cooperative.
My last question, you're from Punjab?
Ma'am, I'm from Haryana.
You're from Haryana?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Tell me something about the skewed sex ratio, very briefly.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, in 2011 census, we Haryana scored really low on child sex ratio at 871, which was very disappointing. And it also highlighted the grave issue of patriarchy, in which is which was becoming deep, but after certain projects like Beti Bachao Beti Padhao, recently a report came that the child sex ratio has increased to 922 from 871. And even one speech by the chief minister, he claimed that it has gone up till 950.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Agriculture sector is under a lot of stress.
Yes,
many of the state governments, you know, they come out with different schemes.
Yes, sir.
What exactly is the problem of the agricultural sector?
So agricultural sector, just like you said, that many states have come up with different schemes, which also highlights that agricultural problems, which have been seen as a monolith right now, have different problems in different regions. For example, if we consider the schemes themselves only, like Bhavantar Bharpai Yojana of Haryana, it basically is a price deficiency scheme because farmers over there do not face such problems as basically landlessness, but they face market.
Many of the states have resorted to loan waivers.
Yes, sir.
Is that the right kind of strategy?
Sir, farm loan waiver is a very short-term measure which can have long-term consequences which are bad for the economy. For example, it discourages compliance in the banking sector, and it also basically benefits only 20% of the farmers.
Okay. Now, there is a lot of talk going on about, you might must be reading in the newspapers, universal basic income.
Yes, sir.
What is this concept, and will that provide an answer to this?
So, universal basic income is basically an unconditional cash transfer which is given to the people of territory regardless of their economic status. UBI came into news after the Sikkim chief minister said that.
There are various estimates available about the kind of money that is required.
Yes, sir. It won't solve all our problems, sir, because we are a developing country. But
UBI, how actually this is proposed to be implemented?
So there are different models, sir. For example, there was, I recently read QABRI, Q-U-A-B-R-I, which was quasi-universal rural income, basically. So
the existing subsidies will be withdrawn.
Yes, sir.
That is what?
Restructuring.
Yeah. India-Israel relationship.
Yes.
How do you look at that?
Sir, India-Israel relationship have been quite deep since independence, but but because of our solidarity with the Palestinian cause and a huge Muslim population in our country, we couldn't explicitly state that Israel is a key partner in our development. But since the new regime has come up, a lot of visible diplomatic breakthroughs have been reported. There is a lot of collaboration in agricultural sector and drone technology and weapon systems like.
Okay. Now, in the international sphere, multilateralism is under stress now.
Yes, sir.
What is the problem?
So, multilateral sector has been facing a problem with the supposed rise of the protectionist tendencies in various countries. For example, Western countries have been keen on withdrawing their presence in the erstwhile oriental countries because they think that globalization is now like slowing down.
Even Brexit, if it works,
yes, sir,
that
right.
Would also be a
pointer
towards that.
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Right. Last question.
Yes, sir.
How do you look at India's balance of payments?
Yes, sir.
India's balance of payments.
Yes, sir. So, Indian balance of payments since 1991 has been in a quite stable position. We have
no, it is under stress right now.
Yes, sir. Because of the falling rupee, sir. The falling rupee value is one reason.
And oil imports.
Oil imports, yes, sir.
No, what is the latest price of oil at present?
So it was $60 per barrel.
But it had gone up to 80.
Yes, sir. Last year.
So that had significantly bloated our. Import bill.
Yes, sir. Also, sir, the trade war between China and US, that has also affected the balance of payments.
So that's a matter of concern for on the economic front, right?
Sir, it is a concern also as well as an opportunity if we can increase our exports and replace certain sectors like soya bean has a very good potential if US has stopped, has increased tariffs on Chinese soybeans, so India can increase its export in that sector.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Right. So, Mr. Grewal, your mock interview comes to an end. Now, a bit of a feedback.
Yes, sir.
This is your first attempt?
Yes, sir. First attempt.
Are you doing your master's also after that? You've been preparing for this?
Yes, sir.
Right. Now, see, it is our experience that the bulk of the questions in the interview would emanate from your dad. Right? Now, you have given your, probably you were born in Firozpur. So, you have given Firozpur in Punjab.
Yes,
so, you know, the fact that you now belong to Haryana,
yes,
some questions may come from Punjab.
Yes,
right? And obviously, the most important issues are that, you know, the Kartarpur corridor
yes,
has come
yes,
up and attempts to revive militancy. Yeah, yeah, sure, please. No, attempts to revive militancy there, the drug issue in
yes,
Punjab. These are some of the things from the top of my head.
Yes,
then of course on Haryana, my colleague asked you very leading questions on
yes,
Haryana.
Yes,
it could be something could come from there. In your hobbies and all, you mentioned your short films.
Yes,
your interest. So something on this.
Yes,
okay. Then you have written some two books.
Yes,
you write poetry.
Yes,
so you could be asked, you know, as to what is the and what other books do you read?
Yes, sir.
Generally on reading.
Yes, sir.
Then you know scuba diving.
Yes, sir.
Then of course tennis and swimming.
Yes, sir.
Since you have said that you have a keen interest.
Yes, sir.
So you know the recent Australian
yes,
Open swimming. Who are our players in India? Who
yes,
are good players?
Yes,
why are we not able to compete at the international level in these two events, swimming and particularly in tennis?
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then you've studied in Jammu.
Yes, sir.
So some questions may come from you know the
yes,
militancy
yes,
in Jammu and Kashmir. Why? When did it start?
Yes, sir.
What about the rehabilitation of the Kashmiri Pandits?
Yes, sir.
That's a major issue. Recently in Delhi, there was a demonstration held by the Kashmiri Pandits and they have been demanding
yes,
that a special township should be created for them.
Yes,
while there is an opposition to that from the Huriyat and the
yes,
others in the valley. Okay.
Yes,
and then of course current events.
Yes,
current events, you know, your interview is on the 19th, so
yes,
it's almost there. Now, current events, you know, go through newspapers very, very carefully.
Yes, sir.
Since you are given foreign service as your first choice,
yes,
be up to date on what's happening around you.
Yes, sir.
In the US, what about US and North Korea?
Yes, sir.
A second round of talks are likely
yes,
to be held. Maldives, I think the defense minister of Maldives is likely to come to India. You know, with China, our issues with Pakistan. Then by the time you have your interview,
yes,
the budget
yes,
has been presented. So, on the budget.
Yes,
then, you know, my colleague asked you a certain question on the, you know, the flagship schemes of the government,
yes,
like ULAN.
Yes,
basically, you know, what he was asking you was that when the companies are giving a subsidized rate,
yes,
how do they make up? It's because of a viability gap funding by the government. Plus, there are many other flagship schemes of the government. Just, you know, have an idea on those
yes,
issues, right?
Yes,
now, the other thing was that, you know, I asked you on why the foreign service.
Yes,
don't go into a lot of details that in college you had friends and all. Just say that, you know, these are the premier services.
Yes,
and it would be a matter of personal satisfaction.
Yes, sir.
An achievement for you
yes,
to join this service.
Yes, sir.
And of course, you know, an opportunity to serve the nation.
Yes, sir.
Okay. It's only if they ask you something like, what does your father do or something, then bring it in. Otherwise, don't bring all those things in.
Yes,
it should be just these two issues in your own words, whatever you want to say.
Yes,
now, the other thing is that, you know, you'll be getting a CD
yes,
at the end of this interview. Go through that very carefully
yes,
and see the kind of questions that you were asked,
yes,
where you felt that you didn't have complete information.
Yes,
so, try to cover up on that.
Yes,
the basic thing is that you must be solid on information.
Yes,
the more information you have, the better you will do at the
yes,
interview. Otherwise, I think you.
Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to never miss an update.